Are you saying?
I'm sorry.
Why do you have two bags?
What do you mean? Oh, because that's what it was really.
Yeah, hosting. I did it too.
Wow, you already said that. Next time. Yeah, I didn't know.
I completely understand.
I need to go like
it. Oh my god, why?
I
think that's why.
No, I can't.
You can. Morning, Karine.
It's not even that hot.
I'm gonna let you back in later.
Very good.
Okay, so how was the first labs? Did you? Well, I know that most of you finished in time, but this is for the first unit lab. So how was the programming this morning for the people? Should we talk about something? Yeah. So, well, I think it's, it's a bit tough schedule for the assignments in the Python in the beginning, but remember that somehow the point is to actually get you into it, so that's going to be easy later. And then there is probably some time to catch up later if you don't manage to get it now, but it's going to be much easier if you learn the things. And it's maybe the most practical use you have. Of course, it's nothing you really can teach. You really need to do it. If you don't do it, you don't try it. It's more craftsmanship than really theoretical knowledge. Right? You really need to have some experience. You have made all the mistakes. So some people it catches faster, some people it takes more time. But it's nothing magic. You have to learn. And I can see that at least some people have watched the videos, but for some reason the Prudent database is only 3 people watched. I don't know if
the link is broken.
Yeah.
The link is broken, okay. So.
It wasn't up until quite late.
Yeah, okay, this one that was, okay, that was private, so I could see it. So now it got four views, me and probably I watched it on 4 different computers probably. Now it's there. I think I changed that last night. As soon as I saw the comments. So, how do you think about the videos? Did you the other ones you could see?
Me and some of my friends, we think the audio was a bit
not quite good.
Yeah, the quality.
Yeah,
it was. We
it
trying
was quite hard to understand some sentences.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, ideally it should be a caption, but there are automatic caption systems. They are not very good.
I think if you added some subtitles or you speak, it will fix the problem.
Yes, but that's someone has to do it. I thought of an assignment that I can assign you one video each and you can do it. What do you think about that? I said, we can do that instead of doing the paper. Google has an automatic system, but with words like any scientific words, just gets completely screwed up. But sometimes we're probably good at it. Yeah.
And then some, like in some of the, well, most of it, all of it actually, the picture of your face kind of blocks the lecture slides, so it's kind of sometimes quite hard to see what
you're
underneath
it. It's but you have the slides. You can look at, you can open the window with the slides next to it. Don't you?
Sorry.
The slides are on the web page also.
Yeah. But some of your slides is actually not in the PDF.
Okay, maybe this should be older, but it might be an older version, but basically most of them are there. So that's, I think yeah, but they're always, you can spend more time fixing it, but I'll try to, the subtitle things is something that, whenever Google gets the speech recognition, I'll fix it. So That's maybe the assignment for you. Make it Google better. That's when you learn some programming, you can do it next week. But at least you tried. That's good. And did you read some of the material also? Some links, basically Wikipedia articles mainly. And that did it help?
In my case, I mean, it's hard for me to understand how much should we know and how detailed should we go with the subject. I'm having a hard time to see what is relevant for this course and what is not. And I don't know if I'm the only one who thinks so.
Yeah, that's the problem when you start having material in the net, because it's really a process. You can jump 20 links and you have the whole world. That's, and of course, I think somehow what's most relevant is what is discussed in the lectures. That's the relevant part of it. But I think that, and also basically the idea is, I think in most cases, the links you have basically Wikipedia articles should be enough. And you don't really, if you understand that should be sufficient. But maybe sometimes to understand it, you need to go deeper. So that's at least the goal. I think there's some page where they have a lot of things in secondary pages. Not on the Wikipedia, but on some of the other pages they have it. But that's kind of then it's like 5 lines the first page. So of course that's kind of really deep. But otherwise, in general, the first page should be enough. But of course, everything that so it's like not. Most of my a couple of pages if you look at it. The important thing is focus on the concepts, what we're trying to. These first lectures are a bit, they're not really anything to understand. It's more like general knowledge, it's a good background knowledge to have if you go further. And I'm sure that some of you already know all these things, but you might have been in life science before, you have used databases, and you have some of you might know much more about genomes than I do. But it's something just to catch up to them, but at least lose with genome. These things, the first lectures are not, this is not really bioinformatics, it's much more of a general background.
Towards the science that have been come up a lot recently, have never heard that before. Could you explain what it is?
What the
Sci-Life
lab is just where I work. Sci-Life. So that's basically where half the people here are in the. It's not formally called the Sci-Life lab masters, but it's called masters in what's called?
Techniques
in life science on that. That's the homepage. So it's. We find a house. So it's actually. It's four universities mainly. It's Uppsala, Stockholm University, Karolinska Institute, and KTH. So, and it's a government-funded research institute that is focused on high throughput science, high throughput life science. And so a lot of it is genomics and sequencing and stuff like that. And there are in total some 500-700 people working there, I think. So in Stockholm, there is one house that is located in Karolinska campus. So it's nothing that you need to know about. It's just I happen to work there, and half the students in this class happen to somehow. You've been there a few times, I guess, for some lectures. And that's so. And because this master program is joined between the three universities also, so it's somehow that's the hub of it. These students went one semester at Karolinska, this semester at University, next semester at KTH. And then they did the master project. So that's how you know. Good. So let's see if there any more questions or before we talk maybe whatever we have should go through today? Anything else that is that's not on the web? So do you want me to show you the slides, or you want me to answer your questions first? I have some questions I got an hour ago, so I haven't really looked at them yet, but hopefully I can answer them. We can do it together. Well, maybe this is too small, I wonder if I can zoom in. So do you know what an ORF is? ORF is, I think, something I mentioned in the text. So ORF stands for Open Reading Frame. So you remember, when you think about DNA, I think you all know DNA. I guess you all know that there are three DNA bases that code one amino acid. And out of these three, so there are 4 to the power of 3, so there's 64 different triplet codons. That is, you all know that. And out of these 64, there are 3 stop codons. So that means that roughly 1 in 20 of a triplet is stop codon, but that's random. So that if you would have a random DNA sequence, you would, on average, find a stop codon every 20 triplets, every 60 bases, so, but most proteins and most RNA genes also are longer than 20 amino acids or 60 bases. So basically, what open reading frame stands for it, that it's an area where there's no stop code for a longer area than possible. So this is something that could code for protein coding gene or even an RNA coding gene, something that could code for a gene that is expressed. So you all get the concept of what I mean with a gene. The gene is basically, normally you think about protein genes, so that most we talk about it. Most of the genes are for protein genes, but you have DNA in the, that is somehow transformed into mRNA, and an mRNA then coded into a protein. So an open reading frame is something from, if you have the DNA sequence of an organism, the chromosomal sequences, you don't know where the genes are. It's not obvious signature, but the obvious signature is that you have a long area without the stop codons. So, of course, if you have 500 amino acids or 500 codons next to each other without stop codon, that's extremely unlikely to happen by chance in the random sequence. And so, what we mean when it doesn't happen by chance? We mean that it means that it's most likely selected for by evolution, so that it's selected so that it doesn't happen. So, there's a selected pressure. But if it would happen by mutation, that would be unfavorable for the organism, so it most likely disappear. Or most likely that organism will not survive, or at least have less, fewer offspring. So an open reading frame is just an area in the DNA sequence in the chromosome that is a potential coding for a gene, not a protein coding gene. Could produce the RNA also. So that's but it doesn't prove really that it actually is a protein coding gene, because you need to have other factors also. It's not that every part of the genome is expressed. You need to have, I guess you need to know what you need to have for a gene expressed. If you know anything about genomes. You have a tata box. Yeah, that's in bacteria mainly. So you need some kind of signal that is occurring before the, or I mean, or not always before, but in the end, there's some signal in the genome that tells you that here in the translation starts, in bacteria with tata box, you have, in eukaryotes, you have a lot of transcription binding facts, and in a lot of facts, other proteins are binding specifically to start the translation. Mm-hmm. Do you know the difference between a bacterial and prokaryotic and my genes or your genes?
We have introns.
Yes, that's one big factor, yes. That's, and also, so introns are. I don't think they exist in prokaryotes, they are basically only eukaryotes. And they are even in, if you look at yeast, they are very rare, there are few intron genes in yeast, but not so many. So, but the higher risk, they are very common. So that means that our genes are split up into small pieces. And how do you think this affects the prediction of genes? So if you take it from bioinformatics perspective, do you think it's, how would it differ between a prokaryote and eukaryote?
Maybe it would be easier to predict in prokaryotes because the intron might change the frame.
And the intron could be very long also, so you can have, so basically the exon part is can be quite short. And if the, and also the signals for the intron exon, the splicing signals, are not that clear. There are some signals there, but there are couple of bases, they are not, they're harder to identify. So in general, yes, and also the regulation, the start sites are much more similar in prokaryotes and eukaryotes. The transcription factor binding sites and all this regulation of eukaryotic genes is much more complex. There can be things that thousand bases away that regulate things. So and also of course, the genome is much bigger.
Circular prokaryotes.
Yeah. They are mostly circular, not I don't think of all, but mostly circular.
Yeah.
And don't think, well, from a prediction point of view, it doesn't really matter. Mm. That they're circular, but they are there, but that's my. So.
But transcription and translation is also co-occurring in prokaryotes, whereas in eukaryotes it's separated, right?
Yeah, but you're separated by the nucleus. So that's. Yes, that's, and there are, I mean, there are many more regulations. Now, for instance, one thing actually that is for a long time was, I mean, one, if you don't, can only don't play the genes only from the RNA, not from DNA, what you do is you can sequence RNA also. You can do RNA sequencing, or traditionally you turn RNA to what's called cDNA, so you may not DNA at all, because DNA is most capable. But you can, so, of course, this is very good information for if you want to find the gene. If you know this is RNA, this is mRNA. And this was sometimes actually easier in eukaryotes because they're poly-A-tables, so a lot of adenosine for them. And they can fix them up and those things. So it's actually easier to do RNA sequencing in eukaryotes. So open ring frames is not necessarily in, but it's something it could be in. And then we have used bioinformatics to actually identify them. And there's one thing that we use now that was hard 10 years ago, and that is the fact to compare other genomes. So how do you think that helps for identifying a gene?
Because genes are conserved in the region.
Exactly. So basically, if you take two genomes that are not going to take me and the cow or something like that, if you look at the parts that sit that are conserved, they're not changing much. That might very likely be genes, and the parts that are changing a lot are most likely not be genes. So that's the more species. Of course, if you see my genome today, you would compare to all other humans, and you know what genes are. So that would be most likely 99.99% of my genes exist somewhere else. Or you can have a chip at the or something. So that's really compare the genomes. You use different genomes together has as a lot of information. But certainly, that's the more similar you are, the better it is. So, well, not too similar, because our genomes, well, most would be identical. The different one in databases on that. Oh, 100, but it's basically our very similar.
So let's say that we have sequencing the genome. So the only way to actually identify which parts are the introns and which are parts of the exons is to go from the mRNA, or is there
more? You can also do a piece that can be compared to other species, because the introns are not going to conserve, but exons are going to be much more conserved. You can use that information also. And there are signals, they're not extremely strong, but there are signals that tell you where the interest and exons are with spider signals. There are some that they are, I don't know the exactly, but if you would predict them purely computationally, you would probably have 10 that would be correct, but it would be much better than random, but it would be many mistakes. And I don't know exact numbers, but there are some signals also. So that's, yeah. So the next question was why DNA has six reading frames? Do you know that?
You have three for the sensor, three.
Yeah. Because genes can occur in both directions. So DNA is not the one way of the mutation. They have genes that are can go both ways. And the three prime ends first, of course, the five prime ends. And it exists in both directions. You have both types exist. They can even be overlapping, and in a small overlapping, the bacterial genomes, because bacterial genomes are compact. So it's not, so that's why I have six frames. Okay, so we have the splicing question here. So basically, it's, as we said, prokaryotes do not have splicing, and even the smaller eukaryotes do not have splicing. I think there also might be some expression in biology, but I never heard about any spliced prokaryotic thing, but it might exist. So next question here is also me, but for someone who has an email. So why does the Y chromosome contain about 10,000 more genes than the X chromosome? So, one factor for it is that it's actually about three times bigger.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, the X chromosome, the Y chromosome. This is wrong. And the Y chromosome contains about 120, I don't know the numbers exactly, but it certainly should have many fewer genes. It's about one third the size of DNA, and it's number 20, I assume it's correct, I check it up. That's actually it's a good exercise for the bacteria for the database. We'll go to Ensemble, maybe. So I will learn something about the database, ensemble.org. And we go to human genome, and I think you can do something here. You can do something now. So you can look at the chromosomes and this one. No, and more information statistics maybe. So here is the human genome. You have 3,500,000 base pairs. 3,500,000,000 base pairs. You have 20,000 coding genes. It seems like something with chromosomes there. This is basically how they do it. First, what you do is you do an assembly. You take your short reads and do it together. And then one thing that is very problematic in human genomes is that you have a lot of repeats on all eukaryotic genomes. You have a lot of repeats, so things that are copied by many times. They often have to deal with that specifically. I don't know what role computer you mean, but then you do some model building filtering, and then you create fine, and then maybe calculate all the seven genes finally by some model building or filtering. It's also probably the actual time to do it manually. You see, we find something here about the chromosomes. Let's go get. This is the best database on it. How many genes are only one from trigger? There you go. If you don't want to go to iPhone 6 screen, and this goes on Y. But I guess we can go there. And here you see that Y is much shorter than X. So if you click on X, you have 155 million DNA nucleotides. Number of genes.
800
to 900. Oh, is that some 800 to 900, yeah. And you go to Y instead, you go to 50 to 60, yeah, it's about. So it's much, much fewer. Basically, I'm not really an expert, because if I understand what I know, but I think it was early mammalian evolution, about 300 million years ago, the X and Y chromosomes, before that, so some reptiles do not have X and Y chromosomes. They decide sex by temperature or other facts. They will just change the sex, like this. I think it's part of the Jurassic Park films today. The dinosaur machine sector. And gradually, basically, the Y chromosome has lost all the genes not needed. It's a regulatory factor, because in most cells, you have two copies of every gene. In most cases, the only one that is being expressed. And it's like, particularly, and of course, if you have a regulation, particularly the Y chromosome, in X chromosome, if it was both were expressed, basically, women would have twice as many proteins as a man would have on all the genes, or these 800 genes. That would probably not be very good for the cells, because they would have twice as many, and you want to regulate the balance. So, in most cells, among women, it's only one of the Y chromosomes that is actually active. Another one is one of the X chromosomes are active. So this is, and I guess the way to regulate that in male is that basically all the genes that you can have been lost from the Y chromosome. So that happened, and it might happen, not directly, but after 300 million years of evolution. So it has been some system that in the women, one chromosome is basically shut down and the other one is used in most cells. And in the male, it keeps only the essential genes in the Y chromosome. They are gradually lost. So there are 50 to 60 that are, I guess, mainly gender defining in some way. And in general, the X chromosome is quite slow evolving. It's harder to. Because it's also sensitive, we only have one of them, so if you have a mutation on them, it's much more likely to be bad than if you have two. So that's one of the good things about sex, is that you have two copies of the chromosomes. You really have, even if one was wrong, you still have another one left there. So there is a high chance of survival, and there's also. That one might get lost in the next generation. It's classically an inbreeding in the royal houses of Europe, where all the male had hemophilia. Yeah. And not all, but many of them, because the gene that gets specific on the Y chromosome, but one copy is okay, so women survive, but the men have 50% together. So that does certainly does show why sexual selection is good for more stability and survival of the species. So that's, yeah, so this is basically why there are many more genes is because basically we men have lost the number one. 300 years, million years, and that's probably a regulatory reason. So the next question was about codons. So as noticed, we have between, I think two can only have one, so between one and six codons for different amino acids. And it's, yes, it's true, it's not a perfect correlation, but there are more codons for the more frequent amino acids. So that's, it's actually not, I mean, it's maybe not five times, six times more, but it's really the most common amino acids have more codons. There's some other interesting things about the codons we will discuss a bit more later, but for instance, that amino acids that are similar to each other have codons that are similar also. Because if you think of mutations of course occur in DNA level, and in many cases you don't want to make a very drastic change with amino acids. But you change from a hydrophobic to another hydrophobic, it's quite likely to be okay. If you change from a hydrophobic to a short amino acid, it's less likely to be okay. So that's why the amino acids that are similar to each other are more likely to have codons that are similar to each other also. And it's also, if you look at the codon base, it's also that the third codon is often not that important. Because most of it to have, in many cases, you can have all combinations of the third codon and you get the same amino acid.
Is it more frequent for a specific kind of amino acids, for example, the hydrophobic or some other characteristic to have more?
Don't think so in general. I mean, it's basically how common they are. It's like the least frequent ones are tryptophan and cysteine, I think. Probably the least frequent ones. They are for specific, and they're not very common in acids, in proteins, probably for protein's sake. So I don't think, but I don't think it's really, you can generalize it, it's more, and tryptophan is very big, so that doesn't fit in my case, and cysteine you make that alpha bonds, so you want to have very specific places. So there are reasons for that. I don't think it's a charge or polar or bias in general. Not that I know about it. One thing to think about, I remember we talked about a lot about evolution in the beginning of this course, and it's what, of course, at least in general theory, which is probably correct, at least the first approximation, is that all mutations occur randomly. So there's no preference to have mutations in different places, but then it's a selection. So mutation occurs in a place that is bad, and it makes the organism unhappy, might make it have less offspring, then it most likely will disappear. Okay?
And all mutations, let's say they happen everywhere with the same frequency, but is it equally frequent to be repaired wherever they happen?
It's. I mean, the repair mechanism, I mean, when I talk mutation, that probably that includes the repair mechanism. So, this assumption that occurs equally well already is not completely correct. But there are preferences, there are things that you have CG next to each other, you have high, when you have more mutations, because it makes the DNA more unstable. So, it's not a perfect assumption, but it's a good first approximation. And there are some studies in E. coli that there should be more mutations in some areas and other areas. Nobody knows why, but, I mean, but approximately you can assume that everything is equal likely. And then of course you have likely to have purine to purine mutation and pyrimidine to pyrimidine and then the purine to pyrimidine changes. So there are, of course, all mutations are perfectly equal, but it's a good first approximation. What makes protein structure prediction so difficult? Well, this is basically what we come back to later in the course. But we come back to how to do it and what we can do. But so basically, the old claim here is what's called Lieventhal's paradox. So that as you know what a protein looks like, Jonas? It's a long string of amino acids. And amino acids have different properties. And if you just calculate the numbers, amino acids are at least there are three different conformations in between them. So three different ways of binding. I mean, at least after you have the beta sheet, but they also have one more. So at least if you assume that you have three different stable states. And then of course if you have 100 amino acids, you would have 3^100 different conformations. And this is just because this is exponential increasing. There's 3^100 is more than the number of atoms in the universe, it's a gigantic number. So if you would look through all the 3^100 combinations, that is completely impossible. And so that's one reason why it's difficult. So that's not computationally possible. But it was. At the same time, we know that proteins fold quite fast, falls in the milliseconds of that. Or the bad protein method. And that was Anfilsen's studies on lysozyme in the early 70s showed. And so we know that proteins can fold themselves. We could assume that we could simulate this motion. It's that at the moment, to simulate it, we will study more on that in the course in biophysical chemistry later. But basically, what you do is you calculate all the forces between all atoms and you iterate that over a short time step, like some picosecond. And then you move the atoms a little bit and you keep on doing that time after time after time. The problem is that, still, if you want to do that, that's two problems. One is actually we don't know if we can describe the forces as the background. In particular, like water is difficult to describe very well. So, and all these other things change. But we are getting better at it, I think. And secondly, the other problem is that even today, with the fastest computer in the world, we can maybe simulate a millisecond, but not a microsecond. So we are really, we need to take some small steps. We need to use picoseconds, 10 to minus 15 seconds. So if you would like to do 10 to 15 or 10 to 12 calculations for getting for every atom in a protein and all the water around it and everything else to simulate 1 millisecond. So it's just to simulate it for as long time as it takes to fold is really in general not possible today, but I mean, we are maybe a factor of 1,000 off. But for small, very fast folding proteins, we can do it, and it has to be done. But they are very small and very specific. They are known to fold very fast. So the problems are basically the computation, the space, the conformational space is very big. And secondly, is that if you would like to simulate as well as plan based computer software. So. Yes?
A question. You said it's not possible to follow 1 microsecond.
There have been no millisecond simulations have been done. Yes, microseconds I don't think so.
What do you mean nanosecond and microsecond?
No, I mean micro can do it, you look at the milli, you know, 10^-6 seconds can do it, not as a minus 3.
Okay.
So that's it is the fact. You have order 10^5, 10^6 atoms in a box, and ideally you should like calculate all the parallel directions. There are not lots of interactions to calculate. And that takes a little fast. But a computer can do 10^9 calculations per second. So, we can have them together.
Sorry.
Yes?
Did you just say if it like naturally form crack out, then you could potentially take as is like taking this longer than it's hard to.
There are a few like very small proteins, like there's one called tryptophan K, 29 amino acids.
Okay.
So basically, it's like two sheets and a helix and a big two particles in the back. So it's very fast folding. It folds in almost nanoseconds. So that one you can fold in the water, yes. And it's more complex problems. It's not obvious that the energy functions we have are accurate enough. But and of course, time scales are also. The systems are much bigger and at least 1,000 times slower. So you will need at least 1,000 times more computing time than I have today. So it's 1,000 times computing time is basically waiting 10 years if you follow Moore's law, you would have it. But it's not obvious that the descriptions we have are good enough for that either, because the energies are quite small differences between the unfolded and folded states. You need to be very, very accurate in every energy. Kind of force. We'll talk a bit more about it in a later lecture. Okay, someone asked about figure one in this lecture. In this slide, I guess it's this one. So this is, this is a bit of in early days of genomics, people just said, well, what should we learn from it? We know things. And one thing, so they had looking at data, and for instance, what they illustrate is that there are some general things, like that there are this is evolution rate is for some in the Gaussian groups, that some genes evolve faster and some slower. And it's most likely, so you may want to do that if you want to take two genes from that are related but in the same organism. And two different organisms, so you have some of these organisms, so they evolve split at the same time. And you just count the number of differences. And some are very, very conserved. You have histones that are almost perfect conserved from yeast to human. And you have some, HIV is something that even and then somebody GP120 puts in the HIV is changing between the cells in between the different virus products in your body, fine, not in our body, so in HIV infected people. So there are, and it's, there are some things that it's not different on mutation rate, it's just that the selective pressure is much stronger sometimes than others. And if you can't count its rate, you count mutations per year or mutations per generation on that. And you do that, you get to see the sum are fast, some are slow, but you have an average. And that average is different between different organisms.
Sorry, can you talk a bit slower, because it's really hard to follow you.
Okay, I'll try. And what you see, the next one is actually, if you look at the genes that are fast evolving and slow evolving, is that you have an average. Proteins that are fast evolving are less frequent in the proteins that are less common. So they are so basically the genes that are you have most copies of. So you know, this is not that you have copies of genes, but you have copies of the. I mean, you have proteins or mRNA as measured. The ones that are most copies of in a cell are the ones that are most conserved. On average, but you see this variation. And you see that you actually do it often log plot here. This is a general phenomenon in many things measured, is that you have what's called a power law distribution. So I can phrase it if you look at gene families, protein families, genes that are similar to each other. And you look, so genes can be duplicated, we'll talk more about this later, but genes can be duplicated from one gene. So you can have, so for instance, we have about 600 G copy receptors, so they are smell, so this is one of the biggest families. So if you look at how many copies you have of a gene family, and you take how many families of that size exist. You will see that you have a few families with very, very many copies. And then many families with very few copies. So we follow what's called a, let's take an initial plot log of these, we get a straight line. So you will have, so here would be EPCRs, and here would be some random protein that will have one copy of. And this is a general trend in all organisms, it's not exactly the same. But you can then divide these genes in, for instance, in different categories. I don't know really what, how to divide it here. I don't know, but you can assume that you have, if these are often regulation, things that involve deregulation or these external interactions like the PCRs, the more complex the genome you have, the more complex you have. But if you're the basic metabolic genes, you only need one enzyme for glucose regulation, and just that you need one. You only have 10 copies of it. And the bacteria need one, so we need one. So there are a few genes, families that are not dependent on the size of the genome, but what others are. And particularly, that's related to regulation and to other, interaction with the surrounding, basically, both in the cell and in the genome, or that's also. So you can see the general trends, and I think this is, the power law distribution of, and you can see similar trends if you study interactions with genes and that. You can learn other things there. Okay. Let's go back to the board. So I mean, of course, people have not used these models of the model. How has this evolved? So in an easy way is actually if you want to just have many copies of one genome, it's just model where every gene is equally like duplicates. Then if you duplicate one gene, so two copies of it, you're twice as likely to get a third copy as you are from one gene, they only have one copy. So it's like a richer model. But sorry, there are selective pressures for that also. So this I'm sure Javier said something about coding and non-coding regions are differentiated in the case of complete new sequences. So if you would, I guess that you wonder really how a new gene would evolve. Is that correct? What's Javier? Yeah. So this is, it used to be a theory before the genomic era, that basically all genes were old. It's very extremely rare to evolve new genes. You would assume that it's quite difficult for it to evolve and start and be functional as possible. But it seems like, at least in yeast, and probably in bacteria also, it is, and probably in humans also, but it's hard to see, is that there are a number of genes that are on the verge to become a part of the population by being expressed. So this is a process that things can, expressed a little bit on trial, and then if it is good, it stays. I mean, most of them will probably disappear. So there are much more pieces of RNA that get translated, and then now and then, very rarely, they occur. Because you can find that if you take an organism, and that there are often a few genes that are not found anywhere else, that seems to be unique to that organism. It is at least the most, one theory is that they are really occurring all the time. And how it happens is quite hard to say, because sure, you need to have a start code and a regulatory mechanism, and you can assume that it's just you have few mutations and suddenly you get start code, suddenly you get the tata box and you start expressing, but it's it's very hard to detect them unless they really are doing something. So if you see them in the genome, we don't often know if they are really just there or not. We see the DNA, but we don't know if they ever make any proteins. And it's also a common factor that the genes disappear. You often have, I mean, if you went back to this ensemble browser here, I had it. If you look at what they have in the genome, the human genome, human, if it's zoom in here, this one, you see you have 20,805 coding genes, but you have also 14,181 non-coding genes. So that observed genes. They're basically genes that are it looks like genes, but it somehow has Stockholm in the middle. So it probably has been coding sometimes in low time in some ancient species, but now are seems not produce proteins anymore. It could also be that in some of us they are actually really functioning proteins, but in some not. So really genes are appear to be lost and gained all the time. But it actually it's very hard to understand really how they appear the first time around them. And in bacteria, it's even harder to study because there are evidence of lateral transfers. You have exchange of genetic material between bacteria. So to see something that is unique to one bacterial strain doesn't mean that it really has evolved from scratch. It might have come something completely unrelated to another bacterial strain. Someone just jumped there by a fake stage or something. Okay. Does that answer some of your question? I mean, basically, we don't know. Does that answer? Second generation sequencing. Yeah, it's so. In the original sequencing techniques are basically variations of. I think this is the part that I have. So the traditional sequencing is basically Sanger sequencing. Yes, this is Sanger, yeah. So he got the Nobel Prize for sequencing sometime in there. So basically what you do there is that you you somehow truncate, you mean make the DNA, you truncate the different places and you separate the sites by column and then you mark it so you know what the last residue was if it's in the beginning, I used radioactive nucleotides, but I think now they just the fluorescent ones. It's a good technique, but you actually need quite a lot of samples. That's why it was expensive to do the first human genome. But the good thing is you can also do a reading out of 800, 1000, even maybe 1500 bases. You can have quite long reads. It's after some time the DNA you can't separate them by size any longer, but you have accurate reading for around the 1,000 bases. So it works fine. The problem is really that it's expensive because it's because you need a lot of material, PCR, the product, etc. So, and then for the second generation methods are actually, it's a group of several different methods that use different techniques. But I think the whole many of these are based on the synthesis of genomes. So instead of using the purifying and cut off the genome afterwards, just use some synthesis instead, I guess. So you have, for instance, the first one was the 445, for instance, which is sequencing, pi sequencing. So here instead you have a sequence technique and then it's fluorescent by synthesizing the DNA. And then you get some kind of signal whenever you see a certain base. So there's an A here, And then you can calculate this. You can measure it when this occurs, and you can then get the sequence of that. And then the good thing about it is that in this case you need to use much less samples, that's why much cheaper. There are also these Illumina's methods that are more based on So you basically have some cells where the DNA is attached to, and then you somehow match whatever is you also synthesize the primer on the strands. You can synthesize different primers, and then you so basically from the synthesis you get different primers, and that somehow you can get the sequencing. I guess it's then you have tagged nucleotides, so you can also see, depending on what primers you can get sequences. The bad things about these methods in general is they are much cheaper, but you get much shorter reads. So you get with Illumina often you have reads of about 20 or 50 nucleotides. So you have a very short part. So if you want to assemble the 3 billion human genome from all these short reads, that's very, very difficult. So you need to use some additional tricks to do that. So you need to use nowadays of course you may match it or they exist. But per sequence is way much cheaper. And nowadays, what you call, I guess you don't think you call it 30 even, but nowadays you basically have methods of trying to do single DNA. So basically, you synthesize and you measure only one nucleotide at a time. So you don't even have a multiplex, so you need time to do a single nucleotide. So you need a sequence in. So it's nanopores that are. Of course, it's much less material, and that's the cost, material cost. And they are, because you really do one DNA at a time. And actually, also, you get quite long reads. Probably to some extent, you have very high error rates. So you have like every 20 times wrong, but you have to do many times to get rid of these errors. So basically, these are techniques that are used for minimizing the amount of chemicals used, because that's the cost. This is not the main. This is not the main part of this. The bioinformatics class. Exactly like what. How can we predict interactions between proteins? It's a whole. I think I have a talk about it. I'm not sure if I have time to go to them, but it is a problem, and. You would really say that interactions are, there are experimental techniques for identifying interactions. You can try to purify complexes of proteins in order to interact. And of course, from that, of course, you can train predictors or things like that also. But there are a number of signals that people use. For having and one in bacteria, for instance, you have these operons, you have genes that are next to each other and all expressed all these three genes are expressed by single regulatory mechanism. And most of these proteins that are from the same operon are interacting one way or another. And they might not always be physically interacting with each other, but it can be that you have two different synthesis. You have one. Regulation. If you have tryptophan in your cell, you will turn on these 5 genes that all involve these tryptophan synthesis, and then of course the product from gene A goes to gene B, etc. So they might not be physically interacted directly, but they are in the same pipeline, in the same metabolic pathway. So and of course they are also more likely to interact physically. There are also methods that compare genomes to each other. So if you, for instance, take a bunch of genes that only exist in some organs but not in others, they also quite likely be part of the same pathway. So if you have really, I mean, take a bacteria that has flagella, and you will either have all the genes that are in flagella or none of them. So there are, and if you combine all these methods together, there are also methods that use three-dimensional structure of proteins, there are and then of course all these high throughput methods are expensive analysis. You can basically purify one protein and try to find and bind to it, or you can have assays that have two proteins. When you tag the proteins, and if they're close to each other, they have your signal. But all these high throughput methods are quite noisy, they're not perfect. So you need some bioinformatics to analyze them. And there are a lot of small scale studies, and of course they are not even easy to find. I mean, there might be a paper written about it, but these are not systematically analyzed and put in a database. So what people do is that, and reading thousands of millions of papers is not very easy to do. So that's why you have computers to do it. So one actually text mining. You let the computer read every few million medical papers, and if two proteins occur in the same sentence, they're more likely to interact than if they don't occur in the same sentence. And if you have a better computer library, you can try to understand exactly what it says also, but that's more difficult. So often you combine the things. So one of we have this in the database data, we have this string, database called string, that has 9 million proteins and 184 million interactions. So if you take an example here, you end up with this kind of interaction map. So my protein here, whatever it was, CDC15, is predicted in this case to interact with all these other proteins. And you can see here that it uses a number of different methods. So neighborhood means that it looks at the genome. Gene fusion is an experimental method of gene fusion. Co-occurrences means that they actually express together. That means that they actually are in the same genomes. And co-expression means that they are actually expressed in the same experiments, in the same cells, or same cell cycle genes, something. Experiments here is probably some high throughput experiments, low throughput experiments, some databases, and some text mining. This interaction here is done by some experiments. So they have some synthetic growth defect assays. So I guess it like means that if you knock out both of these together, they affect the expression blood line or the cell dies. There's some experiments that you can probably click on and actually figure out which is what. So it's from another database and has a description of what the experiments did. So someone has collected all these 184 million data points, and not one person, but a number of people have put it together there. So there are a number of different ways of detecting protein records. They're all quite noisy if you want to do large scale, but they are, if you put them together, you can get quite reliable predictions. We can prove that interactions are not very, very well defined. It doesn't always mean that to produce data like that, they mean that they actually are just doing things related to each other. Genome evolution and human usage bias. So there are quite large variation in codon usage. Basically, codon usage is the fraction of G's and C's, you know, and it varies from, I guess, 20-30% to 67%, basically. There is, it appears to be some selective pressure. I think it's partly has to do with the temperature and stability of the genome. But to a large extent, I don't think it's known why, but there clearly is a codon bias. And of course, the codon bias somehow affects the amino acid sequences, but mainly for these new genes we talked about that are expressed, created. It also is Maybe some is actually it's a way for making back ordering not to get mixed up with each other. So you really have if you have two related species and a different codon bias, the genomes can be too different, so you can't have you can't fuse together again. But I'm not really sure there's any good knowledge about really why what determines the gene content. Or maybe about codon usage bias, or it was about gene content. Tanya. what's your question really about?
Basically, I hadn't really heard about the term before, usage bias. So I was wondering about it.
I think my answer was wrong. I think code use bias is basically that you have six losing codes, and you sum it much more frequently than others. This is, I think, so basically. And that's the case. And there are some. I don't think people really know why, but there are some. Sometimes it's actually related to the number of tRNAs you have. Because of course, if you have six lucids, you have six different tRNAs. Well, some of you have more, I think. So basically, you have one tRNA for each codon, and they're not always in the same level. And there are probably also some regulatory mechanisms for that. There's also some indications that actually you don't want the protein synthesis to go too fast sometimes. Because it needs some time to fold something, there are some particular codons that make the RNA stall, so it really goes very slow through the ribosome, at least in some very particular cases. So there might be something that you want to regulate the speed of synthesis. And of course, if you have a codon where you have very few tRNAs, it's going to be slower, because it will be less likely to have a tRNA in place. So there are probably could have something to do with protein folding, protein synthesis, and it also could be have something to do with tRNA levels for some reason, how that is regulated is another story. But there has been some indication. And I think it is mainly due to bacteria. I don't think anyone knows in other organisms at all. And then we have I guess same question about laws of evolution in genomics again. Do we have something more, or should we go back to it again? For classification of organisms, is it more common to compare sequence similarity between whole genomes or specific regions, and what are advantages and pitfalls? So, organism classification, you have divided, I think, into prokaryotes and eukaryotes. I mean, bacteria is very, very difficult because really you have so much change from half a genome to the end, emerging fusion. It's actually quite difficult to define what is an organism. But we all know what E. coli, and we think that this is E. coli K12, but actually there are E. coli that are twice as big, that's twice as many genes. And E. coli probably differs by 1 billion years of evolution. So there are, even in E. coli strains, they're all E. coli, and they are very, very different. They're more different than we are from plants, probably. Bacteria is very hard to find an organism. And therefore there are a lot of changes, a lot of things that are there. But in general, when you want to calculate, I guess you mean an evolutionary tree, you want to calculate how genes are related to each other, how protein organisms are we related to, more related to chimpanzee than a gorilla? Or to the dolphin? You take, nowadays, it's a bit difficult to take. I mean, you take a set of genes. You don't take the whole gene. Again, you do the gene level, not an organism level. But the genome, there's a lot of rearrangements. We don't have the same number of chromosomes as the chimpanzee gorilla. They have two more, I think. So you often do the gene level, and also you probably have to. But you don't often know what's only one gene. You have to take a set of genes that have evolved. Hopefully at a constant rate and also as the not too fast, not too slow. But if they hit histones, they don't change at all for 100 million years. But if they some other, maybe you take some of the immunoglobulins, they maybe change too fast. So you will see, you will lose the signal. But there are classical examples when you want to figure out, like the example I gave in the late lecture is a panda's a bear or a raccoon. And that was often you have the 16S RNA common gene, I think that was first using that. But that's something that every organism had, you can eat. I mean it was done in the 70s, so that you can easily extract it. And you have many copies of it. So it's easy to find. Mitochondrial DNA is also sometimes useful because it's you have many more copies of it. When they did the studies to compare humans and Neanderthals, actually you don't see anything on the mitochondrial DNA. You need to do it on the full genome to see anything, the important things.
Do you have a small thing?
Okay, so I'll try to continue. I think we should not spend too much more time on this lecture, otherwise we will not have time. I don't know how many questions are about the database, but maybe fewer. Next question was about protein structures, and they are about the differences are pretty equal often in protein. Beta sheets are less common in alpha helices, but so basically you can divide proteins into, I would say, four or five main categories. So you have the ones that are, first ones that are in the membrane or outside the membrane, so we'll talk about that later. And the ones that are in the membrane, you can divide into two classes that are all alpha helical or all beta sheets. And the beta sheets, the beta barrels, are only occurring in the outer membrane of gram-positive bacteria and in the chloroplast and the mitochondria. So there are much fewer of them, in particular in other organisms, gram-positive bacteria. And the rest are all alpha helical ones, at least the ones we know. And then among the proteins that are soluble, that are in the membrane, you have the ones that are all alpha, the ones that are all beta, and the ones that are beta both. And I would imagine that I would guess that all beta is fewer, but I don't have I would guess that it mixes the larger group of these. But it's not a huge variation. So the preference of the surroundings is basically in the membrane and out of the membrane. We will come back to this much more later in a couple of weeks. So how accurate are frictional structures? Yes, of course, there are experimental data, and the experimental data is the structure that we have determined. So we want to predict this, that's the data of the experimental data. And it really varies, if you mean accuracy, you have, we will also come back to this, but there are, if you do by homology, and you do the best predictions, they are as good as bad experimental structures, I would say. And then there are all the ranges of that. So there's also something we'll discuss much more later. What is taken into account in order to predict gene expression in different cell types? Gene expression is actually difficult to predict, but basically, it's a complex machinery, so the load transcription factor, even thinking about transcription factor binds, the binding size, it's not at all trivial. So I don't think people really have any good ways of expressing what is expressed where and how. People have, so it's, but basically what we want to do is to take into account what transcription factors you have. So the transcription factor is a protein that binds to some piece of DNA. And then you have, so basically you can take into account, okay, if this is transcription factor there, you can take into account what other, what binding sites exist for that in the vicinity of a gene. But it's in the human set, it's very, very hard. And I don't know about any good method to do it. There are good databases, there are good studies, and you can study a lot of data for it, but really to understand why and how, I don't think anyone can do that. Kuno bias, and that's a thing we covered. So the coordinate structure, that's basically the same thing as protein interactions. So that you go back to protein, it's, in principle, you can use the same methods as predicting protein structure. So basically, it is that if you've seen the same coordination of proteins before, seen structure before, and if you use a similar set of proteins, they're homologous, you can assume they interact in the same way. That's the best way to do it. So that's so basically, if you've seen it before, you can model it again. There are some other methods that have worked in some cases, but we will also talk more about that later. Relationship between crystallography and bioinformatics. So crystallography is also an experimental method for determining the structure. That was first structures of myoglobin from 1950 something. Or 60X maybe. Which is basically a full course of some deeper. But basically what you do is you try to get a crystalline structure, and you take somehow you put it in a chemical solution that makes it crystallized, and then you try, you shoot X-rays on it and you get a diffraction pattern. And for that diffraction pattern, you can calculate the structure. Which is not that easy, but you can do it. And for the bioinformatics, what is that? Part of your bioinformatics methods for evaluating the structure, so you have analyzed and proved the structure later. And all those methods also to predict the structure using this as a training function. And we will talk much more about it later. I don't think we should be into too much detail now. Okay, so next question is about DNA assembly, which is certainly a very difficult problem, and particularly this relates to this first and second generation of DNA sequences. Now, the longer pieces you have, the easier it is to put it together. So, it was in the original idea of the Human Genome Project, what you did was actually that you took the chromosomes and put it in what's called BACs, so bacteria or human chromosomes. You took like maybe 10,000 or 100,000 or I don't know, maybe 100,000 bases together and put it into a circular chromosome and put it in bacteria. So you divided the human, every chromosome into many, many small pieces. And then you sequence each of these pieces one by one. And for the smaller pieces you had, the easier it gets. So if you have 100,000 and each read is 1,000, you can imagine you can maybe get something else and just try to put together, get things overlap. And the big breakthrough of Craig Venter and Jean Myers and Bioinformatics, when it was, if you remember, I think I was talking about, it was a race between the public consortium and the private consortium to sequence the human genome first. And the private consortium was run by Craig Venter and colleagues. And there the opportunity was to use shotgun sequencing. So basically you take the whole genome, just randomly shot it out to small pieces and then just sequence what you can from each piece by itself. So you don't do the step of taking the chromosomes and do one by one, which is, you know, very, very time consuming. And people have done that before for small bacteria, and you should, I mean, Craig Lampton and those others have done it before and showed that it actually worked. You could do it this way. But it was not, people, most people didn't believe that it was possible to do it for a human genome because it was too big. But then there is a few tricks. One trick to use was to actually use to try to get all the sizes that you get for the shotgunning about the same size, maybe it was 10,000 base pairs. Then you can sequence both the 3' and the 5' end of it. So you have two pieces here that you have six of, and you know that there are quite exactly 10,000 base pairs from each other. So that's a very good handle for making putting things together. You know there are these two pieces together, and then if you have something else here, then you can start picking up things. So that's, and you know, also for the number of algorithmic advances to do in computational efficient ways, but in principle, what you just take it, you take it there, if you have the same sequence here, put the next one here to the top of it, and you just build up. So the trick is that you sequence it many, many times. You don't sequence it, you know, once, you sequence it 30 times, or 50 times, or 100 times. Because some parts can be sequenced many times, some parts can be sequenced at all. And every genome project is like, you're probably going to spend half the money to get the last 5% of the genome correct. So what we're talking about is how many contigs, how many, if you run your algorithm, how many pieces are left. Ideally, in the human, you have 24, or 23 plus the Y chromosome. So, but I don't know what, how many contigs have in the ensemble now, but it's very rare you have everything, you always have parts of the missing, you can't put together. So even in, I think in the human genome probably have it, it's one contig per genome, but if you take some bacterial genome, many people give up, because the last parts are very expensive to find. And there are also, even in the human genome, there are these highly repetitive regions. That are basically just easy. Of course, you can't see that. You can't say that 1,000 or 10,000 is copies because they look the same all over. It's highly repetitive. There are parts you can't sequence. But in general, it's just a big puzzle. You take a piece together, you put it together, and let the computer work on it. And it's. I know it was a big problem because in Scilab lab, they were working on the sprouts, the CRISPR, the GRAM, the tree. You know, and the, many of the plant genomes or tree genomes are very big. So it's about, I think it's 30 billion base pairs, it's 10 times bigger than human. And it was a very, very big problem together. And they had a competitor, I think it was Canadian company, or Canadian consortium, that was always catching up with them. And the main reason was because they had better computers. So they could have one of the fanciest computers and run it completely on that computer for 2 months without anyone else. So the really computational part of it is a big part of it. So, but it's really the whole idea. I mean, it was also a big surprise to this shotgun sequence that it actually worked. And you really got to do random things. And that was a surprise for most people. And nowadays, with these new techniques that are just appearing the last few years, and that's actually not, of course, we have longer reads, you probably can get better samples also. But there are two techniques and they are not widely used for men or women, yes. They are mainly used for human genomes. So basically, yes, you don't randomly nowadays. I mean, you basically ultrasound occasion or radiation or something to break it down, it's just put it there and it breaks down. But we had to try anything in the beginning. Okay, anything more about the genomes? The genomes, we should go back to the databases. The database shouldn't be that many questions, I guess. I think that now it works, I think. I think I was some. So what do you do with errors? So maintaining a database is a pain, and it's a general problem in bioinformatics, I would say that it's very hard to get money for a database. So really, people get money from new experiments, but to maintain a database, it's not very sexy. I published version 27.5 of this database. Like, that's your PhD. But it's extremely important because some of these databases are used by everybody. So, and of course, one of the problems is that there are errors. No database is free of flaws. There are errors for every database. And in general, you do not, you update things. You keep a history, you could find what was there earlier, you can keep an earlier version. But of course, you don't keep an error. If there's something that was an error, you have a version 0.2 of that gene, whatever you have, and the new data is there. So if you take the latest version, you don't get the old error, you get a new one. But somewhere the old data is stored also. So why do you put things in databases? Actually, it's true. I mean, the major breakthrough from the database is that most journals require for at least some type of data that you put in the database. So for sequencing, if you want to publish a paper, you had to put it in the database. For protein structures, if you want to publish a paper, you had to put it in the database. Some of these databases allow you to have it on hold for 6 months, some of that. So that's not released directly, but it depends on the data. In general, I think the community of genomics have been very much for open data. So most of the genomics projects have all the data gone out on the web directly, even before they publish it. But it varies very much from community to community. So in general, genomics are more open access than proteomics, I would say. But even sometimes, if you put a data there, it's not always easy to understand. You need to have quality control and you need to have some data. The one I remember in the early days of protein structures, where you didn't have these requirements, so people published pictures of these proteins. And of course, someone had to write a program that could take, and they had to publish stereo pictures. So you had a picture of, so you can look at the stereo glasses. And then, of course, from the stereo picture, you can actually back calculate the coordinates. So you also have someone made a good program that could calculate structure from the stereo picture. Well, it's not perfect, but it's quite good. But nowadays, at least for protein structures, I think for proteomics in general, for genomics, you have to deposit your data in the database. And there are, in most cases, there are. But in other data, if you do big medical experiments, it's not required, and that means that it's very hard to get the data. And then, but it is a problem, how do you get the money to maintain it? Primary database hold one type of specific data. So what I meant here is basically also primary data is just deposit. It's that, so like in genome sequences, it's a genome sequence data. And it might be not annotations on it, but basically it doesn't cross-reference other databases. That's a secondary database that actually takes things together. And also you interact with databases. So if you go to Uniprot, something like that, you have a lot of information that's taken together. Then of course there are also like derivative databases. For instance, in my field of protein structures, we have PDB, which is depositor PDB data, and you have a nice interface to it, a lot of references, a lot of links, etc. But then you have specific databases, maybe all memory proteins or all transporters, to summon down, and then have those additional classification of it. So they are more derived because they use their own algorithm or manual inspection or whatever to do some additional value to it. But they're based on primary data. Interaction maps. We talked about that before, and we will probably get back to it later also. But in general, I mean, as I said, interactions is not extremely well defined. So when I think about interaction, I really think about two proteins that are physically touching each other somehow. while many people talk about genetic interaction, that means that human must be a regulatory mechanism. You can have protein A is expressed in the is regulating the expression of protein B. They're never ever in physical contact because A is a transcription factor that makes B being expressed. But of course they are interacting in some metabolic sense or some regulatory sense. And sometimes people are not very clear exactly what they mean. And even these physical interactions are very different types of physical interactions. Now every protein has been interacting with the ribosome when it was produced. At least once. And but also if you have big complexes, remember ribosomes, many macromolecules that are physically tied together. But then there are of course only some other proteins that are just, I mean, G proteins in GPCR are, well, they're binding, but it's not very strong binding, it's just temporary binding when it gets activated, or phosphorylase that, or kinase that is just doing an enzymatic reaction on another protein. So there's also an interaction, but it's not a big complex. So interactions is a very fussy concept. So it's not always very clear what people mean in the interaction database. So in this string, as we looked at before, they actually have, they are somehow putting all these things together. It doesn't mean that all these proteins here are physically interacting. They could be. So the CDC15 is the protein kinase, and the CDC14 is the protein phosphatase. So they might actually just be interacting by that they are acting the same substrate. I don't know. But. And this is a GTP binding protein that is maybe that's the substrate of, you know, this. So it really doesn't mean that my physical sample but they're not part of the complex. If I will guess.
Sorry.
Yes?
The color of the edges, is that way they predict each of the interactions?
I think so, yes.
So how can we know from that the number of predictions that they have found? For example, between two different proteins, how many evidences they found?
Well, the numbers are down here.
Yeah.
So this is some kind of score, so this is like 99.9% chance to be correct. I mean, this is their sample they have on the homepage. This is like something that's very reliable, so it's quite. And of course, I think you can probably even take away the color somehow. Here you really have the evidence. This one here, I mean, all these interactions are by experiments and text mining. Except this one also has some, at least those are some databases interactions. But you can go back and take some other example. I think this is number two, so you take example number one instead. Yeah, tryptophan, tryptophan. This is a tryptophan synthetase, so it's part of tryptophan. And tryptB is exactly tryptA, but that's probably not very much of a physical interaction, because it's just two parts of the same pathway. And the evidence here, I mean, it's also very, very reliable, because I mean, that's the example they show. And its neighborhood means that they are next to each other in some genome. They are gene fusions, even in some, gene fusion means that they actually are, in some organisms, somewhere, these two genes are fused to one gene. Because they are, I mean, that's efficient if you want to have subset A or subset B, because connect to each other. Co-occurrence means that in some organisms they are both there and some they are not, none of them are there. You have co-expression, that means that in some part of the cell cycle or some experiments they are both expressed, not expressed. When you have tryptophan that are expressed, when you want tryptophan they're both expressed. Experiments means something else, a mix of different things. Databases means that there are some database large case. Text mining means that they are in some abstract sets that are part of the same pattern. So yeah, that is, so, and I'm sure you can filter this in some way. If you want to see some time, you can do it. But so interaction can mean different things. What tools are used to evaluate the quality of nuclear sequence data, especially in the genome? Basically, all databases have some type of automatic and manual quality checks. But for protein structure, there is quite a lot of tools available, because you can maybe look at check the protein structure makes sense. And you can also you deposit experimental data. I think there are, I'm not an expert in it, but I'm sure there are some kind of data quality checks on genomic data also. You can probably check the number of contents, number of pieces you have. There are probably some other statistical tests you can do. So there are certain tests to do something, but it's clearly not perfect. It's like there is a lot of noise in the data and databases. And so you always have to be careful exactly what is there, and you have to be able to take into account. I don't expression data, I don't know really how this checks it on, but I would assume that it's on somehow. But there are some quality numbers, because you need to do it all over. But gene annotation, that's something you change all the time. The number of genes in the human genome has dropped by 3,000 in the last 5 years. So really, that's really how do you annotate the gene? Most of it's all manual actually. You have to have manual check on it. Someone from my database, Brent Ansons. So that's about, enzymes and ligands. So I don't know the database, but if you look at it, of course, this is one thing you can look at, when was the update last time?
Information
somewhere? Yeah, maybe. Getting to contribute. Click on copyright news. So it's at least it's quite new, 2016. And it existed for 10 years. So it seems to be something that they have money for and can keep it running for 10 years. That's a good sign. And we can also look at the site. But there is most of it. I mean, many databases are published once or twice and they die. So you write a paper and the student who did it graduates and nobody else wants to do a second work on it. Unfortunately, that's a difficult problem. Took now my system by all your databases. Well, that would be impossible. This NOAA database, but this is just an annual publication, or I guess it's several publications, that is just database issue of NOAA, which is NOAA is a good journal if you do RNA or DNA work, but it has an extremely high impact factor, and that's because some of the big databases publish there. Like the gene bank, they publish every year, every 2 years, publish a new issue of it, and then they do something. That's what everybody likes it. So there are a lot of databases that publish in NOAA that are also, they exist for 1 year, 2 years, and then disappear. Well, probably they still are online, but not updated. So it's basically online publication, but it doesn't really, it has no intent to be complete of everything. I mean, the big databases that are probably useful are, I mean, really to go to the database providers. If you go to EBI, for instance, so here, of course, you have a lot of databases that are there. and NCBI in Japanese also. They are big providers, and it's not everything there, but they are some links to other places. And they are some of the few people who really have money for maintaining databases. So the main databases are probably found there. Ensemble is, I guess, it's not really official about an EBI, but it's.
And NCBI as a primary source.
And then, and then you have Genome Japan, which is. But this I never use, so I can't really say. I mean, you're in Japan, right? Maybe it's actually very good. I just never use it myself, so that's probably my bias. But and I'm sure there are. If you go to, I would expect that there are some big Chinese courses, but my Chinese is bad, so I can't read it. But the big databases, the genome, the protein databases, are all synchronized between these sites. And some of them are maintained more one side than the other side. And some are duplicated version of it. So that there are, for instance, if you take the protein database, you have Uniprot, which is the United, but it is the European version, the Swiss prot, and you have an SBI version, which is not as good, I think. But the Americans tend to use it, and the Europeans tend to use this European version. So you use string compared. The string is a specific database with interactions. That is just talking about interaction. Make sure that links are the data. Uniprot is a database you should know about. It's very useful. And it really tries to put everything you know about a protein together. And to know the organization, how Uniprot looks like, if you have a manual part, manual creative part, and an automatic creative part, it's important. And of course, most of the data you have here is just links to other places. So you have, for instance, you can have, if you want to go to the genomic data, you go to EMBL or to GeneBank. So you have this, or the Japanese site. And you have a link there. You click there, you go to, and you get the part of the genome here, you see where it's expressed. So that is a very important factor between these databases is that you want to have links between the different databases, so you can find one way into another. So most of these interfaces are made for people that want to get one gene or two genes. But of course, by partitions, you want to download it, you want to run, compare all the genes on there. So then you need to have good programming tools to do that. And all of these are available. You can download them yourself, or they have good programming interfaces. You can do automatic queries for them. Why? So you also you're going to have three structures for you, but I should be able to do that. If you look at PDB here, maybe there is no structure this protein. Well, there is not a structure. There are structures of models of this protein. You would put a model portal. You can see that so this is a portal, a database of models of protein structures. So this is your sequence that you start with, this P2, whatever it was. And you see that there are a number of models that cover this region of the sequence. So the first 200 residues of it. And I guess you can probably download them, I guess. There's multiple. So there are man, if Uniport is correct, which I guess it is, there's no structure directly of this protein, this DAPA, but there are structures of homologous proteins that are most likely good enough, but there's some estimates down here, that's good enough for making a model that is accepted. So this one is made on 4-chain sequence identity. It means that the structure or sequence is 4-chain identical. And we will do much more about this later. And if you have 4-chain sequence identity, you can make a good model. So yes, there's no structure directly to this protein, but there is a model. And on the other hand, at this sequence identity, you can easily make a model yourself. Just go to web server and you make a few clicks and you wait, take a few minutes. Or maybe 10 minutes. But there are people already made it. Okay. In this case, yes, string is the main information stream is not to show all information about a protein. So the information stream gets about a protein is probably, I mean, I'm sure it's obtained from Uniprot. Just select to show some part of it, not everything. So in Uniprot one, you have lots of other information. You have all these GU annotations. You have information about post-translation modifications. You have parts that are glycosylated. You have different domains that we'll talk about later. You have references to papers about it. You probably have some disease-related databases. It contains a lot of information. If you know what you're looking for, imagine Uniprot really should contain most things that are known about this protein. And that is also because this is in Uniprot SwissPort version of it. It's not in the template. If you go to Uniprot like that.
Isn't SwissPort curated?
SwissPort is manually curated.
So I think that's the main difference between Uniprot and SwissPort.
So they're both part of Uniprot. It's just there are two different parts of Uniprot. One is called Tremble and one is called SwissPort. So they are both. And basically, SwissPort is manually curated. It doesn't mean that it's 100% correct, but there are someone who has at least spent some time looking at each entry. And of course, the difference is that that's 500,000 entries is 71 million. So this is much more data. So that data is and the annotation there comes purely from automatic pipelines. They are running some computer program that annotates it. And in many cases, that annotation is very good, but it's less reliable. And particularly, if you start, some of these even sequences are not perfectly correct here, because they come from genome databases, genome sequencing, and you have gaps, you have arrows, you have noises, etc. So it all depends on what you want to do with it. But even in SwissPort, we just did an analysis of subcellular localizations, predicting where in the cell protein is, and we developed a new predictor, and we found 500 cases where our predictor was pretty sure that it was in one location, but SwissPort said something else. And I'm quite convinced that at least in many of these cases, the annotation is wrong in Uniprot. If you go there and look at it, you find an old paper from 10 years ago, 15 years ago, with a weak evidence that is there. But someone has read this paper and put it there. There was some evidence for it. But the experiment was wrong, or the interpretation was wrong, or it was not good enough data. So there are, and of course, nobody has looked at it for 10 years. So even if it's in SwissPort, you can't always trust it. I mean, generally it's very good, but it's not perfect. Okay, that was all the questions. So what do you think about this format? Do you learn something from this discussion, or is it better that I have to repeat it the next one more time? Someone is nodding, but you learned something. Someone is falling asleep. Very few people left, at least, that's a good sign. No, nobody threw tomatoes. Is this good for me? Okay, so now some of you will go to lab and keep on working, and I will see you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Thank you.